May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be as pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So we've been meandering our way through the creeds. It hasn't exactly been a race, has it? And last Wednesday we looked at the sort of the first section on Jesus. And it's talking about Jesus in the context of what it means to be God. So this is on page 123 in your green prayer books. Some people use the term sort of cosmic Christ in describing that. And now what we're going to do is we're going to move into, transition into a different mode. We're going to transition into the earthly experience, if you will, of Jesus. And I want to make the argument that we need to understand Jesus as a miraculous event, the entire life of Jesus. Now, when I talk about a miracle, there are various different ways of approaching what it means for a thing to be a miracle. And one of the ones that I think is helpful is some tags that go on to them, or criteria. And they get some fancy titles. So it's objective, subjective, and symbolic. I had to look those up, don't panic. So objective means that it actually happened. That makes sense. You know, you can't have a miracle of your, say, something, a dream or something happening and count that as a miracle. You know, it had to happen. Objective. Subjective. You have to go, wow. I mean, because it's got to have that sort of impact on us. Otherwise, it's not a miracle, it's just a thing. You know, and it could be a really unusual thing, but it has to have some impact on us. So it's objective, subjective, and then symbolic. It needs to point to, and I will use the term kingdom of God. It's got to point to grace. It's got to point to something more. So historically, we're now kind of moving from Christ in a almost in a philosophical sense, in an eternal sense, and it starts, as it does with almost all of us, I suppose, with the birth. You know, it starts as an event, a moment in history. However, we'll read this. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, and is ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. So, we do a little loop in this section. Starts with, comes from God, with intent. For us and for our salvation, there is intent. There is his life on earth, and this points very briefly to it, doesn't it? You know, incarnate. Do you know what a carnivore eats? Carnivores eat meat. Carne is flesh. Carnivore is eating all the meat before Lent. Incarnate into flesh. It's not fancy, it's just from another language, so it seems fancy. So, of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. We read that every year from Easter time. He suffered death, actual proper death, was buried. And on the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. So we get the loop back. We get the loop back to where it starts, in a sense. So yes, first objective. There are some people who argue that we can't really know if Jesus existed in history. Those people are not historians, though. They're not. I have yet to come across a reasonable historian who makes that argument. The historical evidence for Jesus is as good as just about any other person in history, if not better. So in history, yes. So that's the objective component of what it means to say Jesus is miraculous. If we could get a Doctor Who's TARDIS and go back in time, it'd be pretty cool. But yes, we would find a rabbi named Jesus, except he wouldn't have been pronounced Jesus, Yeshua, and Ben Yosef, son of Joseph. And he was a teacher. Happened in history. Subjective. Now this is where perhaps it gets a little bit fuzzy. Because we see an impact on the people that Jesus spoke to. We see that recorded in Scripture. And the very fact that it became Scripture is a sign that it had that impact on them. But if that's all it did, if it only had an impact back then, it's no longer miraculous. The impact needs to continue, and it continues in us. We read Scripture, we hear it, we respond to it, that in us, it just goes, wow. There's no wow factor. It's not enough. And then finally, it needs to point to something more. And regularly in Scripture, we see Jesus pointing to the kingdom of God. And in our own lives, it needs to point to more. It needs to point us to more. The dream that there can be more in our lives, more life, more goodness, more grace, a deeper appreciation of the presence of God in our lives. For us, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. This is something that I keep coming back to in my own thoughts about Christianity, about God, about life. And it's this notion of death and resurrection. And it's an echo that I keep coming back to. It's the power of the resurrection. And I'm not here referring to the historical event. I'm actually referring to the personal experienced event of resurrection. Now, I don't mean that I've actually died, been buried, and 3 days later got out of the grave, because that's zombie movie stuff. I'm talking about in our own lives, where we go through times where it feels like everything inside has been burned to ash. When we go through times where it feels like we can hear the laughter of other people, but it sounds like it's an echo only. When we go through times when our soul is hurting and broken, and it feels like everybody else can't quite see or understand, when we experience death within ourselves, and yet there is life. And we look back on our lives, and we go, that was a time when I felt dead inside. And yet there is life. We have a personal experience of resurrection. And it's an echo of that of Christ's. But it's an echo that we, when we reflect on it, we can go, wow, because I know God was with me in that. At the time, it didn't feel like it. At the time, it felt like no one was with me. The friends that tried to be there were just faking it. But we can look back and we can go, wow, God was with us. And so it then becomes up to us to understand that in the end, we return to God. But in the present, we have a responsibility to point with our lives, with our actions, with our words, to that which is greater, to the kingdom of God, to grace, to hope, to life. In the name of God, Father. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.